I didn't really know that record production existed as a job, or that what engineering was, even though I kind of knew the names of engineers and producers on various records that I bought while I was growing up, and I was kind of very excited about the whole idea of it, but I had no idea of how to actually go about doing anything about it. So I my other main interest was art, so I studied design at college, and sort of learned some of the basics of quite a lot of different areas, which was quite handy later on. So theatre sound I did, and lighting, because I was concentrating on doing theatre design primarily. And so yeah, learning that kind of stuff became quite useful later on. In fact, I've even in recent years been working a bit on film and theatre with Underworld and Danny Boyle, and I ended up working back in the theatre at the National Theatre with Danny Boyle on a production of Frankenstein, which was great. It was almost like going back to my roots. I actually got a job as a delivery guy with a studio hire equipment company called Audio Rents. They were based in Primrose Hill in London, and I got to know a lot of the equipment that was being hired out and used in studios. I also got to know where most of the London studios were located, and I got to know quite a lot of the engineers as well. And when our local studio, which is called Mayfair, ended up needing a new assistant, the guys who worked there already knew me from delivering stuff to them. They asked me if I wanted to have the job, so that was my first position at a kind of proper full-on studio. And it was very much a top studio at that time. I suppose the time when I took a step up from being an in-house engineer up into the next level really was the track All Together Now by The Farm, which I ended up mixing sort of quite by accident really, because my friend who'd originally got me a job at Mayfair, Noel Rafferty, who's one of the other engineers there, he'd been working on this track, but had to go away to go to a wedding. And he suggested to the session that I took over, and they wanted to mix the track. Also, I did some program. I was into programming very much by then, and I had a sampler and an Atari, and they needed loops, programming and things, so it all kind of fitted together quite nicely. And I worked on it for over a long weekend, and by the Monday morning it was finished. I, you know, thought it was good, but I wasn't kind of prepared for the fact that it turned out to be this really, really big hit. It came out pretty much 2 weeks later, and I heard it on the bus when I was on my way to the studio one morning, because I used to play Radio 1 on the buses at the time. And suddenly I realised there was this stuff. And it's not like I hadn't had things released before, but it was the first time I'd had something that I'd mixed come out and be a hit and was getting played regularly. And obviously it was a big track. It was in the top five for about a month over Christmas that year. And suddenly I was a mix engineer. So I think that was really a defining moment for me. My first connection with Nelly does date back to Mayfair as well. Nelly was involved with Soul to Soul, and used to come into Mayfair for various sessions, sometimes Soul to Soul stuff, but also quite a lot of remixes. It was at that time of the sort of late 80s, early 90s where everything got remixes done, and there were budgets for doing them in expensive studios. So I tend to be working on a remix pretty much every weekend and then doing other sessions during the week. So I spent a lot of time with Nelly then, and I ended up mixing one of the Soul to Soul singles off their second album called Missing You. And then we, you know, went our separate ways later on, but a few years later, after I'd been doing all the work with New Order, and I'd been working with Sly and Robbie as well, a few others, Boiler House, our paths crossed again, and Nelly had opened his own studio and his own label, and was looking for somebody to mix on stuff for his label. And I'd done a mix for one of his artists, sort of independently, which everybody liked, and so he asked me to come and do some more. And from then on, pretty much over the last 15, 16 years, we've been working on things together. I've mixed most of the stuff he's done since then, so. And yeah, for a good 10 years, we did all of that in his studio in London, which was a fabulous place. And since then, I've set up my studio, and he now sends me things to mix from time to time, so. Yes, great thing to come along. Nelly had done some work with U2 before, and he was friends with them. He'd done a track for Batman film, I think, that they'd done, and also they'd written a song for a James Bond film, which he'd worked on. So when it came to their next album, they asked him to get involved in doing some extra production on some of the tracks, primarily tracks that were slated to be singles. And we did three of those on that album, How to Dismantle an Atomic Bomb, at Nelly's studio. And we're sending mixes back and forth. We did it over, you know, they have a fairly luxurious time scale to their stuff. So we did separate sessions and different occasions and mixed things to a degree. And then they get a little bit more work on the arrangements and stuff. And we'd mix more and so on until it was done. But yeah, it was great to be working on something like that, because U2 were a band that I'd sort of grown up with, really. I'd bought their first album and been to see them when I was still at college and stuff. So it was quite weird to be ending up working on one of their records. I didn't know that the mixers or engineers would won Grammys when records won Grammys. There are different categories. We were lucky enough that we'd worked on two albums actually in the same year that were both nominated in the Album of the Year category. And if a record wins Album of the Year, then the producers and engineers all get a Grammy, which is, I didn't know. And a couple of months beforehand, we were just finishing off at Christmas, went out for a meal with Nelly, and he said, "Oh, did you know that the U2 album and the Gwen Stefani album are both on the shortlist for Album of the Year?" I went, "Oh, that's nice." And said, "And if one of them wins, we'll get a Grammy." And I was like, "Really?" So, suddenly it became... I didn't really think too much more about it, but then when the ceremony thing came out, they sent out invitations and got an invitation. It was a bit of a thing to go over to LA just to go and see this, but I was persuaded to by my wife, who sort of made the point that, you know, it could be my only opportunity to be at something like that. And so I went and was sitting there when they read out the name of the album and started listing everybody's names who had worked on it. And I was trotting off up to the stage. I was way further back than everybody else, so I had to really run quite fast. So yeah, it was a fantastic feeling. Probably that's got to be one of the big highlights. I'm doing a lot of work with Underworld. I've been working with them on and off for the last 6 years or so, since their album Barking, which we did in 2010. And I've done a lot of work with them on Danny Boyle projects. The biggest one being the Olympic Games opening ceremony, which was pretty enormous and took a long time and wasn't allowed to tell anybody about as well, which was quite fun. And at the moment, yeah, they're just going out touring with a new album, and I'm putting together a lot of their live stuff. They've got a live SSL desk now, and I've been programming that for them. I also did a Paloma track not that long ago for the Rugby World Cup. And I'm working with some other new bands. I'm also doing a bit of teaching as well at the Academy of Contemporary Music. So I'm kind of trying to keep my options open. I think in the current climate, you know, it's good to diversify a bit and do some other things. So doing the things on films with Underworld and live stuff and a bit of teaching, as well as doing all my other mixing, is good. I'm working on some development projects as well with a few bands, a couple of whom we're gonna look at in the in the pieces that I'm going to do here. A guy from Cambridge called Ethan Ash, and a band from Colchester, FOX, who I've been working with for quite a while. I guess Pro Tools really is the first port of call, because that's where most of the stuff happens, putting the track together. But I'm also a fan of analog and outboard gear, and I used to have a bigger SSL. Now I've just got a baby SSL, which I use for summing and various routings and stuff. And then I've got my rack of outboard, which is pretty important to me. I'm not quite sure what I'd do without my without some of my compressors and things like that, and outboard reverbs and stuff. So I use a real kind of hybrid method of mixing, and it's been getting more and more hybrid as I've gone along. And I, you know, it's quite possible that one day I'll end up all in the box, but I like having things coming out and having faders and being able to mute things in and out and tweak. Well, just an insight into everything that I've learnt over 30 years, and hopefully I'll be able to explain the reasons why I do things, why there is a kind of process to it in terms of the practical stages that you can do, and hopefully it'll make... I think mixing in particular is a quite a daunting prospect when you don't have a lot of experience, and it's very hard to know where to start, I think. It's definitely something that my students struggle with more than anything else. So I think having the system that I have and having a kind of logical process to it is a good way of going about things. And there's a way of organizing yourself that makes the whole process of mixing a lot less daunting and a lot more fun as well, I think. So hopefully that'll come across.